to the republic for which it stands.
One nation, under God,
indivisible,
with liberty and justice for all.
Guns, self-defense, conceal carry. This is the Patriot Defense Podcast. From the war room in Idaho's high desert, here's your host, Todd Echols.
Okay, let's try this again. Here we are. It is Friday evening. It's smoky out. We're tucked away in the war room in southern Idaho, and we might break into coughing fits.
Mesothelioma?
Cough. It's not that kind of podcast.
Don't turn your head when you do that.
It's not that kind of podcast.
No, that's
well, if you're in California, I'm pretty sure the air would be illegal right now.
Probably. Yeah. So I went out yesterday.
It has been known to cause cancer.
I tried to run like 4 miles yesterday. I made it two and went, no more. Turned around and went back to the truck.
Well, 4 miles is 4 miles. I run 2 miles per month. I drill once a month. I run 2 miles.
I try to do 4 miles multiple times a week.
I can run if I want to. I just choose not to.
Oh, I kind of like it when I can freaking breathe. I found out, you know, yesterday I needed oxygen to breathe, not smoke.
Ah.
My dog would look at me. I'd be waking up. It looked like I'm hungover and drunk, and my eyes are bloodshot, and it's just
Izzy too
horrible. Yeah, Izzy too.
Izzy's hungover.
Izzy's hungover too. So, okay, we're gonna start with Mark here. Mark,
yes.
What have you done that? Well, in the last couple weeks? I don't know. Couple weeks, I think. That's been Second Amendment related.
Well, because of the last time I was on, I shot the TP9. And I liked it. I actually liked it. So,
what's the TP9? What is that?
It's the Canic TP9.
You missed shooting
it's the Thanksgiving gun.
New one.
It's the it's the turkey gun.
You missed the Turkish gun.
Yeah. And it shot. I thought it shot really well. Actually,
it was awesome. That kid who owned it picked it up. And how old was he?
14.
He picked it up and he kept a group like this. He was awesome with it.
Yeah, I kept a good group, and I went and found one in one of our other stores and had it sent to me. So I haven't got it yet, but as soon as it gets here, I'm buying it.
Which one did you get? What color?
The black one without the decocker on it.
Okay.
Yeah. Without the what?
The decocker. The decocker spaniel.
Here it comes. Here it comes.
I got
you had something in the gears just stopped.
He was trying to bait him in a little bit.
Well, on that pistol, it doesn't really make any sense because it's a striker fire pistol, and if you decock it, then
you just
you can pull the trigger all day long, it won't work.
It's made in Turkey.
If you decock the thing, then you have to cycle it.
Yeah, it's referred to as the dead man's switch.
You're essentially racking the slide, picking it up, putting it back in your magazine, and now you're ready to go.
Yeah, it's essentially called a dead man's switch, just because by the time you get the next round, or you know, you're
a dead man.
I didn't even know the damn thing was on there. He showed us all last time. It's not a regular, like doesn't look like a safety. It sits right on top of the slide. Weird.
You just push the button.
It just looks like it's flush with the slide. Yeah, so you wouldn't even.
Yeah. It kind of reminds you of the buttons on some of the old rifles. When you cock the bolt, that button pops out.
This doesn't pop up or anything.
It's actually just flush. So it looks like it's just a design on the gun.
The firing panels, like you'll get the striker indicator sticking out the back. Like an HK
or like a
VP9 or whatever. So once you decock it, it that striker goes forward, but it won't actually hit the round. It just.
Why in the.
I don't know. It's Turkish.
What is it? It's ISIS, isn't it?
Well, no.
They've infiltrated Turkey now.
We will send these to the infidels
and they will never kill us.
That's why I shoot Glocks.
True.
He's the Glock guy.
I'm a Glock fan.
Dean.
So I had a conversation at work. And
people talk to you at work?
They have to because I'm a provider.
You're the boss.
Yeah, because I kind of say, you want your drugs, you got to say stuff. So, no, one of my nurses says, hey, I want to get a pistol. What should I get?
Great. Did you tell her all about revolvers?
I did. I told him all about revolvers. He needs to get a revolver. That's the perfect first gun for someone who's never had one before.
I got one. I'll sell him.
It's safe. It's all it needs is a screw.
Isn't that never mind?
Never mind. Yeah, we won't go there. That's another pay per view episode. Yeah. No, but I told him he should go down to D&B, talk to a guy named Mark behind the gun counter who knows all there is to know about stuff. You know Mark?
I know Mark.
Right? Yeah.
I've known him a long time.
So I said, go down to D&B, talk to Mark. And I said, you'll probably end up getting a 9mm. You'll get talked into a 9mm, yeah. But, you know, get what feels good. Doesn't matter. I told him to get a 45.
I think Mark needs to sell him a 9mm revolver.
I can do that.
Well, I've noticed if you talk to any gun retailer, if you don't know what you're talking about, you're either going to end up with a 9mm or you're walking out of there empty-handed.
Don't know what you're talking about, you're going to end up with a 9mm.
Well, it's just, I mean, don't get me wrong. I'm a great 9mm. I love 9mm.
What is that all about?
I love them, but here's the thing. If you go in there and you talk to them and it's just like, hey, this is my first gun. This is what I want. This is what I'm looking for. And they're looking, oh, I'm going to get him a 45, him or her a 45. I'm like, oh, they can't handle that recoil. Let's go to the 9mm. Because nobody wants to sell a 380. It's 9mm.
I'll sell a 380. Like if it's 380 easy.
They're nice.
They are. I owned a Bursa 380 Thunder.
Bursas aren't bad, actually. Yeah.
Actually, if you're coming into the gun store and I work there, I'd send you back out there with a DB9.
A DB9 Diamondback.
Everyone needs a Diamondback just to remind them what it feels like to be alive.
Hey, as long as it's not a Sky.
No skies.
Yeah, Sky, I was reading a thing.
I shot one of those. Hated it.
Oh, I hate them.
They're horrible.
They're horrible. And I was reading an article that said Sky claims that they're the king of concealed carry.
Are you kidding me?
And I'm like, it's on their website.
They've obviously never met yellow and orange and purple guns.
Maybe king of crappy concealed carry.
They're the king of fluorescent colors, maybe. But
yeah. Gangster carry.
Yeah, gangster carry.
So is he going to head down there and buy a gun?
Yeah, he said he's going to head down there tomorrow and talk to Mark, yeah.
Are you over there? Are you down there, Mark?
Yeah, I'm there tomorrow.
Good deal.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good conversation, yeah. Good.
So he needs to, whatever he buys, we need to have him shoot. He's like new to this whole gun thing, right?
Yeah. Yeah, he's never
I smell
had
a podcast episode.
Right, yeah, right, right.
I'm serious.
Yeah, the last time I tried that, I talked to one of my other nurses.
You scared him off.
I know, she didn't want to do it. Well, the rig thing was it's her husband that really wanted the pistol.
Yeah.
And he doesn't speak very good English, and so he's very embarrassed that he doesn't speak good English.
Oh, that's okay.
I'm like, it's fine. Who cares?
It doesn't matter. Tarver comes in here sometimes,
right?
And he speaks Louisiana cunt backwoods country.
Cajun, right?
We still like that guy.
Yeah, he's an immigrant, you know, and a lot of these people are really embarrassed that they don't speak good English, but they speak it fine. They'll come in and they'll say, "We need an interpreter," but I'll talk to them, ask them the questions, you know, and they're fine. They understand perfectly well, and they respond.
I did a lot of roofing a while back, and we did a lot of the. Habitat for Humanity houses and some of the government subsidies, and we'd roof houses, and they'd come out and watch us roof. You know, what are you doing? How are you doing it? We don't speak very good English. You've been talking to me for 45 minutes, and now you're going to tell me that?
Right?
Yeah,
right?
Like, I heard everything you said.
That's like me looking at you going, yeah, I apologize. I'm so sorry. I'm not very loquacious with the English language.
I spent 6 weeks in Mississippi last year, and they told me I didn't speak very good English.
You don't talk funny.
Around here, stay in Mississippi.
If you talk in the plain English language, everybody looks at you like he's got a degree. No, I don't. I'm just from a different part.
That's an educated Mississippian.
So this kind of moves over to Tory. Tory's a listener. He's taking my class. I told him one day he could join the podcast, and here he is. It's that easy.
It is that easy.
But I'll get a hold of you last minute, like hours to spare.
It is. You know, and he said, hey, you know, next week we'll check it out, see if you can get in. I said, yeah, sure. A couple months went by. I was like, he's busy. No big deal. And then, hey, I know it's last minute, but you want to do a podcast? Well, I ain't got nothing else to do. Sure.
The
beauty of it is I live 10 minutes down the road.
So. Last minute is how I function.
True.
So, and I wasn't sure who we'd all have here tonight. So I need to get the board and get extra mics, and then everyone could show up and it'd be just a big old freaking party.
That's all good.
That might not be good. You might.
Well, it's a double-edged sword. You got to take the good with the bad.
You're going to have like five conversations going on at the same time.
Don't we already have that going on?
Probably.
They call that a sidebar.
Yeah.
There you go. Oh, man, your buddy Zane is all over Facebook
Live. Speaking of the South, that's where he lives. He lives in South Carolina. He's from Hagerman, but he lives down there. I'm sure he's probably talking funny by now.
He lives in South Carolina. He's from South Carolina.
Lives in South Carolina. He's from Hagerman.
Oh, gotcha, gotcha. Yeah. Now he calls himself an Idaho. He's Idaho people, he says.
Well, he was once until he told me he was coming back, and then he wasn't coming back. So I figured he'd gone to the dark side.
There you go. So have you done anything Second Amendment related in the last, I don't know.
Shooting-wise, I just came into a new 41 mag revolver.
Oh, that is sweet.
Good I don't Lord. Know. I don't
Here
know.
We go.
What is
I
it?
I don't know why.
Is it's it a Smith?
Smith & Wesson.
It's a Smith.
It's a Smith. It's a Smith.
The model,
I think we just came I'm up with sure. our show topic.
Does it have adjustable sights?
Yeah, it does.
Okay.
Yeah, it's, okay. It's, so what? It's a stainless one. My dad bought it. It's a Taurus.
Oh, it's a Taurus.
It's
okay.
a Magna-ported Taurus.
Gotcha.
So my dad bought it, and he says, come out, shoot with me. I said, okay, it's a 5-round 41 mag. Worst decision I've ever made. So we go out. He says, let's shoot it. I haven't shot this thing before. And I said, okay. He pulls it out. And oh, shit. That's got that's got holes in the end of it. I put two earplugs in. I put earplugs and I put headphones on. My dad looks at me and he goes, it's not going to be that loud. I said, yeah, it is. I've shot those. And he pulls it out. Wham, two rounds. And he gives it to me. He goes, here you go. I said, well, you're not going to shoot the rest of them? And he goes, no, I'm good. So I shot the 3 rounds out of it and just, I don't like it. It's abusive. It really is. And by the time we got done, we probably shot, between the two of us, we shot probably 50 rounds. And by the time that was said and done, he goes, well, you better put that in your gun safe. And I said, really? And he goes, yeah. I said, why don't you just, go trade it? Well, I don't know. You might, you said you wanted a 41 mag. I said, yeah, but not that one. So I got a nickel or a stainless steel 41 mag Magnum port.
How long a barrel?
4 5/8.
There you go.
And it's ported.
It ported.
We're going to have to.
Yeah, it's kind of cool because when we went out here to the Buell Corrals and shot, and it was right after I got off work, and it was starting to get dark, and I shot, and I'm not joking, boy. It looked like a road flare.
Does it blind you when it gets dark?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I was joking with my dad. I said, here, I handed him my sunglasses. You might want to put these on. He goes, what? I said, it's getting a little darker. Shoot it again. Bam. And he's looking around, and I told you.
That's cool. I smell, wait for flash. I smell another podcast and a little bit of shooting beforehand.
Yeah. I like it. It's I don't know. Like I said, it's a double-edged sword. I like it. I mean, somebody breaks into my house and my wife has to grab it. It's, even if she misses, she's going to probably drop it. And whoever's in the house and the neighbor next door, we're going to have to pay for the refrigerator and whatever.
Did you get a 41 because you couldn't handle a 44? Is that? I'm kidding. No. Dean looks at me like, what the hell are you talking about?
So the only revolvers that I've ever actually owned is, I'm a big 357 mag friend. I love them. I owned a GP100 for a long time. The 4-inch.
I love loved the GP100.
Loved it.
Got a nice little Taurus over here that's missing a screw.
We've been trying
to fix that since the first podcast.
But right. Other than that, really not much. I carry every single day.
There you go. Good deal.
It's good to have another revolver guy in the room. I appreciate that.
You know, if you could meet my dad, you could be a cashier at Walmart, and he will talk to you for an hour.
Yeah.
About revolvers?
It don't matter.
About Trump?
Yeah.
Obama?
Oh, my dad. Oh, yeah. Don't get him started on that. Like I said, my dad is a very, very big Rush Limbaugh advocate, and when it comes to Trump and Obama, I'll hang up the phone on him. Dad, I don't want to talk about this anymore. I got to eat dinner with my family.
Oh, man.
So, Todd, did you do anything Second Amendment related?
Nothing at all.
Did you teach a class?
I did.
Oh, well,
I did.
Okay, yeah.
I did. I had about a big group of guys come in, actually, from my church. There's about 10 of them came in, and we did a concealed enhanced permit class. That was kind of fun. Yeah. They brought in lunch. And
really?
Yeah, it was pretty good.
Really cool. Did the bishop come?
No, he didn't come.
Any of the first, the counselors or the
no.
nothing?
No. Oh, no. Yeah, one of them did.
So does that mean
they talk about me in church meetings? I know that.
They all found out. Start carrying now.
Question is, is it good or bad?
I don't know. They talked about me. And they said, "Hey, do you think anyone in the congregation besides Todd carries?" So they know, which is good. I've always wondered, but you got to be pretty stupid to know what I do and think maybe I'm not going to carry. So
right. Yeah.
I'm hoping that when I decide to go to church on Sundays, they feel a little safer.
That's good. That was my next question. I didn't know you went to church on Sunday.
I do.
You do?
Yeah.
I used to. I kind of fell off the wagon for a while.
I go. I've been working on scouts lately. I got a few to choose from out there.
Tell.
Yeah. Don't even breathe on that brown one. It's about ready to go over. So other than that, what?
So,
oh, freaking spider.
Holy balls. No, at least it's not the dive bomber from the other week that drove off the ceiling.
And I told you the bug assault shotgun.
I know. But how do we have freaking salt everywhere in here?
Yeah. My neighbors across the street have one of those, and we went over for dinner, and my son was blasting away at the flies, and wasn't that bad.
It's not, you know, and I went to my wife. She used to work for Title Fact, and we went to her Christmas party over at the Stonehouse in Twin, and they have this big white elephant deal, and I saw that thing. I was like, I want that. Like, I better get that. And lo and behold, the first ticket I drew for the white elephant, I got it. Well, the rules
stole it from me.
Yeah, I was so mad, and it got stole from me, and it came around to my turn. I was like, I'm going to steal it back, because once it gets stolen twice, nobody can steal it again. Well, the lady right before me knew that her husband wanted it, so she stole it. I was so mad. I almost stormed right out of there.
I'd have kicked her right in the freaking chin underneath the table.
Almost traded her my Glock 19 for it. I really want that.
Well, you got two, right?
Have you seen? I got three now.
We can make that happen. I sell them at TMP.
Have you seen some of the Facebook videos? You can put lasers on them.
Yeah, we sell the lasers too.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
So my son was using this thing to pick out flies, and it was a great teaching moment because we would be sitting right across the counter from the turkey, and he'd blast a fly in here. We'd get pelted with the damn salt. Son, know your target and what's beyond it.
Well, he's trying to salt dinner.
Yeah. Salt. Oh, is that maybe
dinner? I'm going to use it while I'm grilling.
Yeah, that's maybe what you I need want. More sodium in your life.
I want to throw some burgers on the grill and just shoot some salt.
How do you know he's not the smartest hell dad?
I'm going to assault these burgers.
So, hey, let me tell you something. I think I'm going to go to Kentucky next summer.
Ooh, that's a good state. I like that place. I
think I'm going to Kentucky. There's this guy that there's this guy I met online.
Oh my gosh!
Catfish.
You gonna meet him at the rest stop?
No, he's on an international scout page that I'm on, and he actually has set up. They do quite. I don't know if they do any around here, but they do them over there a bunch. And he's in charge of what they call one of them. They call them running guns. And what it is there's different distances. They have anywhere from like a 5K up to like a 10K. Well, what it is you got to go up there with your rifle, whatever rifle you want. I have to look and see what the restrictions are. And a handgun. You got to load down with your ammo. And you go through this obstacle course. So either this 5K or this 10K or whatever it is. And, you know, your heart's going and your, you know, heart's beating. Everything's elevated. And you go to these certain stations and they got a range master there. And he tells you what you have to do. You have to shoot this one with your rifle, this one with your handgun. You have so many seconds to get it done. And they score you on your time it takes you to complete everything, your run and everything, and then they score your targets and combine those together. And he actually has invited me and another guy up there to see if, to check it out. So if I can afford it, I think I'm going
to
go.
That'd be all right. They used to have something like that over in Hollister. Did you ever go to that?
They had three guns there.
Yeah. The one that we went, it was a three gun, but you could choose what you wanted to do.
Oh, okay. But yeah, I'm pretty excited. I'm going to have to actually bust out my AR-15 and actually start shooting that damn thing. It's been about 3 years.
Yeah, clean the spider webs out of the barrel.
I shoot mine all the time.
I don't shoot it.
I love mine.
I'm going to have to come see Mark. I'm going to have to outfit that sucker. I don't know if I need to put a red dot on there or
just borrow mine.
I got an ad core. Mine's all set up. Name all over it.
A what?
An ad core by Bear Arms.
Oh, yeah?
So the M249 barrel is what my AdCore has in it.
Oh, wow.
Oh, yeah. I love that gun. I mean, I've put that thing through.
Spend abuse. More money.
Actually, when we bought.
It's a tax write-off.
Yeah.
So when we bought mine, it was, I want to say, $1,200. And now they've gone up. Because when they first came out, everybody's like, oh, it's a new AR. We'll see what it looks like. Well, now everybody's like, that's a really good gun. Now they're up there in the $2,000 range. I got lucky.
Yeah, I can't afford that.
What's so special about it?
It's got the 249 barrel in it.
What does that mean?
So the M249, saw.
The saw.
Yeah. Oh,
the barrel out of the saw. It can take high abuse. It can take high heat. Uh-huh. You can beat the heck out of it. It's a good gun. It's also got the forward charging handle. So you got the rear charging handle. You got the forward charging handle that you can change ambidextrous.
Okay.
It's got an ambidextrous safety, ambidextrous mag release. You can put all kinds of neat stuff on it. I bought mine with just a flat rail. You can buy the carrying handle for it. I've got mine. It's got the Aimpoint T2 on it, the micro. I've got that. I've got a Vortex that I switch in between. I haven't really figured out what I want to do. I've actually Duracoated mine. I bead blasted it and Duracoated it, taped off the barrel, so it's really nice now.
Holy hell, I'm going to have to spend some money, I think.
So yeah, it's my next and if my wife's watching, she's going to get pissed. But my next
she hasn't logged on.
That's good. So my next purchase, I think, for that is going to be the it's called the PEC 10. It's a red light, green light, and IR light. So you got the red light laser, green light laser, and then the IR flashlight. So if you got night vision, turn your IR on.
Dean doesn't even own an AR.
Oh, you were deprived as a child. I love them. I'm an SBR fan, to be specific. My dad owns a 300 blackout, an SBR. Uh-huh. Love it. He got the 300 blackout, and then he bought all the components for a 5.56 upper. Uh-huh. So you just swap them out.
So you can swap out the uppers.
So on these run and gun things, do most guys do it with a... with a black gun?
I've seen a bunch of different guns on some of these videos. So I still need to ask the guy a bunch of questions, but that's what I'm going to use. I don't want to go buy a new rifle. I'd rather just build the one I have.
In my opinion, I've done a few. Like when I took your class, you'd gone around and asked who's done what. And I said I do a lot of competitive shooting. I love it. It's just the rush.
Yeah, I'm not a rifle guy.
Yeah.
At all.
If you're going to first start it, I wouldn't buy a new one. Like a $2,000 gun. Go out there with your standard. I mean, Colt makes a good one. Olympia makes a good one. They all, you pull the trigger, it's going to go off kind of gun.
PSA. That's what I got.
I've never even heard of those guys.
Palmetto State Armory.
Palmetto State. Palmetto. Okay.
So I'm going to go with that. And I don't know which handgun I'm going to take, but I'm probably going to have to buy me a vest and load it all down.
Hey, I'll let you borrow one.
I got a vest too.
Really? That would be cool.
I got two. I got one. They had a deal last year, AR-500.
The plate carriers.
I bought a vest and I bought two steel plates.
Okay, well, I don't want the steel plates. Yeah, I ain't running with those.
I bought it thinking, because it says right on there, it says lightweight 3. And I bought it and put the plates in. It's like, wow, this thing's heavy. I'd hate to see what they're like non-lightweight.
Plate carrier, mag pouches, all this stuff.
To prepare for that, obviously, I got to build up my rifle, start shooting my rifle a little bit more, get a little more proficient in my rifle. And then I'm going to buy myself a weighted vest and start running in that.
The weighted vest, so...
I'm going to buy like 20-pounder.
What's... I don't even run with mine. I just hike with it. Like, so my buddy Jared, we bought the same vest and we'll throw like one plate in or no plates and just put magazines in and we just hike the hills.
Is the plate just for weight?
It's bulletproof.
It's bulletproof.
100%.
Oh, no shit.
So if you look up, get on Google and just look up AR-500 steel. Uh-huh. They make targets. They make bulletproof vests. They make ceramic plates, steel plates. Me personally, I like steel just for the simple fact that it'll stop something.
Yeah.
I like the dragon scale.
The leather.
It's a dragon scale purpose.
I was looking at that the whole time I got here. Like
one that's called dragon scale that does that. Armor.
That's cool. So I'm gonna get a. Is that from the weighted Lord of the vest
Rings collection?
Kind of. The way they do it. They layer it.
The dragon skin. Yeah, that's. It's supposed to be really cool because the way that it's layered. So if you get like just a flat vest, it's spread over a surface. Mm-hmm. Well, with that dragon skin, when you get shot, it's supposed to spread it over more of a surface because layered.
Yeah. Gotcha.
Kind of like it's like fish scales. It's exactly what it looks like. Yeah. Fish scales.
That's freaking cool.
Yeah, it disperses the impact.
Maybe I'll make a leather one and I'll wear it.
And when you go do your three gun, if
make you a real tight some latex stockings. One.
Yeah, we'll be looking good for this baby.
You got to have something in there that says Patriot Defense. That's going to be in PD on it.
There you go.
Something cool.
See, that's going to be on the other side of the paywall for Patriot Defense.
I tell you, if you're going to do it, at least buy yourself a GoPro. I'm pretty sure you've already
got it. Oh, yeah, I got
it. Wear it, and I challenge you to do the three gun, pull that Desert Eagle out. Nobody will see it coming.
I'll just do it.
Bang, bang, bang.
I'll do it. I shot the thing pretty good.
And everybody will look at you like, he brought a musket.
maybe I'll go do this running gun and I'll take my cap and ball
revolver.
Or even just
so when you get the cap and ball, just put a lanyard on it, shoot it once, drop it, and then pull the Desert Eagle.
You'd have to have a brace of cap and balls all around your waist.
Or go get you the Jack Sparrow belt and stick it in your belt and then pull your other one out.
There you go. So I'll let you guys know how that goes. It won't be till probably, I think it's in the fall, so I've got a little while, but.
Whenever you're ready to shoot ARs, call me.
We got
the Bob synthetic target. It's sweet. I've got one.
The Bob synthetic? Like
so it shoots thousands of rounds into it.
And as long as they're not hollow points, you can shoot thousands of full metal jackets. If you shoot a hollow point, it's like half as much.
Why do we have you on shooters? You got all fun shit at your house.
It all seals up.
You can ask my wife. So my gun safe is in my house. But if you go out to my war room, I guess you could call it.
Yeah.
I've got some good stuff out there.
Wow. I like this.
Yeah, it's fun. We do, when my dad and I come into town, or my dad comes into town, he's a truck driver. When he comes into town, I call all my buddies, and they bring all their stuff, and we'll go out there super early. Like, if we're going shooting at, like, noon, we'll go out there at 10 o'clock. We set up all the targets, because my dad likes to do that stuff, but he doesn't have the time to go set it all up, so we'll go set it all up for him, or we might just do it on a weekend. I shoot all the time.
Fun. I need to shoot more. I have a range right there.
Yeah.
I don't use it that much for personal use.
True.
But I need to. So other than that, that's what I've done. My next class is going to be September 29th, so I've got a little ways out. It's fair time, school time, yeah, harvest time.
Time's busy for us.
It's kind of slow, a little slow. So
you know it's harvest time when all the damn trucks are out riding on 93 and 46, slowing down traffic.
Yeah.
Hey, man.
I laugh so hard. Because I've grown up with it. I've gotten so used to it.
It's money. That's what makes this valley go round. Yeah.
I grew up in Filer, so moving to Buell is just, I see him, I'm not going to make him mad. I'll just drive right behind him.
Oh, Buell used to be worse. I mean, I won't say worse, but a lot more just because of Seneca.
Yeah.
But it's not even half as bad as what it was. But so I found me an article. You sent me an article. Yeah. You tagged me in it on appendix carry.
Yeah.
So
it was actually talking about how popular it's becoming. And
it's very popular. It's all the cool kids are doing it. You
cool,
too.
All the cool skinny cool kids.
we could do a little bit of stamina before we do the podcast.
It's for the cool kids, not the cool whip kids, right?
I got
the
a mean.
The cool kids, not the cool whip kids.
I've got a mean for the core workout. That's good stuff.
You guys could just come. You guys start hitting CrossFit with me.
That's a no-go.
I'll like hit the floor.
I wouldn't say I don't like it. Like, I respect it. I've seen some of them guys getting down.
You can try it twice.
I don't know if I got it in me.
Okay.
I don't like being laughed
at. Well, anyhow, appendix carry. You what?
I don't like being laughed at.
You won't be laughed at. If I can do it, you can do it.
Look at that skinny guy having he's having a heart attack. I better get over there.
Don't worry.
Why is he flopping around? That's not part of the mom.
They got one of those.
That's
the new
burpee.
The wad.
Wow.
So this is a wad, right?
That new burpee looks a hell of a lot like a seizure.
I've been through a lot because I went through basic training. And when I got out of the Army, that's when CrossFit started. Or got out of basic, that's when CrossFit started getting really big. And I'd seen some of them guys like, wow, you're flat getting it. Like, dudes are jumping towers that are, you know, taller than me.
Yeah.
I don't jump into stuff. I just go through it. It's fine. So I have a little brother, and he's the brains of the operation. You got a door here and a wall here. I'll run through the wall. My brother either walks through the door or walks through the hole that I just made. That's how my whole life's been.
So you don't appendix carry, Mark?
No.
You don't appendix carry?
Hell no.
What, have you ever tried it?
You know,
there's a video on YouTube that shows big guys appendix carry.
Yep.
No, it's called panis carry once you get a big guy doing it.
Try it. You should try it once. I got a holster.
You can't even
get
the thing out of the holster because your belly eats it.
That's true.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're
whatever.
Not just pulling your shirt up, you're pulling your stomach up.
So what do you guys honestly?
Your fat apron.
So I know Tori, you appendix carry.
I
appendix carry. So it's 2-2 here. What do you guys honestly think about appendix carry?
I think if you can do it, go for it. Yeah. I mean,
if you're skinny enough to pull it off, great, make it so.
I'm always do what's comfortable.
Right.
You know, do what you train with. If you train appendix carry, then do that.
I think it's fast.
I do. I think it's really fast. We train with it all the time. We go shoot. We're always doing it.
And that's the thing. You got to train for it so you don't shoot your wiener off.
Just got to have good trigger control, and you got to holster carefully.
Yeah.
So in this article, it said basically, you know, you need to slow down when it comes to reholstering. Yeah, well, you should slow down when it comes to reholstering anywhere, anytime.
Yeah. Right.
See, and just to caveat off that, and it was in that article that I read, and I agree with it 100%. It's, you know, if you talk, just to kind of an example, you talk to any cop,
right,
any state, anywhere, they say, I don't shoot to kill, I shoot to stop the threat.
Right.
So if you're going to shoot until the situation's over. And once that situation is over, that's when I'm going to holster my weapon.
Yeah. And you never should be in a hurry to reholster.
Never. I mean, it's there. The hurry comes with the reload, or the hurry comes with getting it out.
Right.
And to me, I mean, even if we're just training, I will shoot, and it will catch me all the time. My friends always ask me, why do you look down at your holster? It's because I want to be able to hit that holster.
Yes.
And it's not because I want to train how to get at my holster faster. It's, I'm going to do that whether I'm getting shot at or it's being safety. Engaged. Yeah. It's, I mean, it's just, I would rather, much rather, whether it's empty or loaded, I'd much rather put it back in my holster and not have to go to the hospital.
So I find myself, and you've been there when we've taught these women and stuff how to reholster. When I reholster, I find the holster and I open my hand up and just kind of push it down in there. So everything's clear of the trigger. There's no mistake what's going on there. I just kind of just push it in or drops right into place. So I was on holsters. I kind of got worked up on holsters on the radio show today. There's this running Facebook page that I was on, and this lady had come up against some bears while she was out running. And they meandered off and left her alone, but she was talking about, what do I need to carry, a bear spray gun, whatever, and then how do I carry? And so I gave her some examples, and some other people are giving her some examples. And you ever see those little clips that you can screw onto the side of, like, Glocks? Or,
oh, yeah, the slide clip.
And someone came up with that.
What's the slide clip? What is that?
It's just a clip you screw onto the slide.
Yeah, it screws right into your slide.
Oh, I've seen that. Yeah. Okay.
And they're like, and I run with this. And I'm like, holy hell, you do what?
Never.
You go, oh, yeah, it's very, very comfortable. And I got into a conversation with her for about 20 minutes going back and forth about, you do you, I'll do me, man. But that's
insane. You need something covering up that trigger.
That's freaking insane.
That's serious. I mean, that's exactly what it is.
And you're running and it just slides over the edge of your pants or your shorts.
At that point, you're safer just running with it in your hand.
Oh, God.
And that's pretty unsafe, but at that point, in my opinion, in that point, you're safer.
Like, so
that.
Maybe you've heard this podcast, maybe you haven't, but Dean listens to some...
A motorcycle.
Idiot motorcycle podcast, guys from Washington, and they're cops. And the one guy says when he goes and runs, he runs with his freaking gun in his hand.
He jogs with it in his hand.
Early That's morning, terrible. He jogs with the gun in his hand.
He's a motorcycle cop. He's law enforcement, active law enforcement. Motorcycle. He runs with his duty pistol.
I tell you right now, I will give up all hope in humanity if Buell PD comes jogging by with
every one of them with it.
Going. I'm gonna run out there next to him. Like, is that comfortable?
Oh, I can't believe that crap. But anyhow, just if you're gonna buy a holster, get a good holster. There's plenty of good holsters out there. I tell everyone. Typically, plan on spending an average of anywhere from $50 to $100 on a holster, unless you want to go with the super deluxe model.
And, with the Wi-Fi and the Bluetooth and the cup holder.
After seeing that, I feel like I could go to, I work for Snake River.
And oh, hell.
I feel like I could take a piece of foam, a little bit of Velcro and super glue. I can make that for about 10 cents.
Well, you'll make my next one then.
Your $200 piece of foam?
Yeah.
Hey, I watched lots of YouTube videos on it.
In all those YouTube videos, you couldn't watch how to make it?
No, I wanted one. You don't understand. That's a tax.
With all that Velcro on there, does that ever get caught in your short and curlies?
Hell no.
You don't. You ever pull off?
Because oh, he's got the female side of the Velcro, so it doesn't catch nothing.
There you go. It's those short and curlies feel good against my short.
Oh my God! There it is.
And we went there.
Yeah, I did. I did. I did go there.
He gets you little drums in here.
Yeah. Maybe when I get my big mixer board.
Yeah. The sound effects mixed into it.
So I want to explain to everyone watching Facebook Live here that honestly, I know that on Facebook Live the audio is absolutely 100% horrible. Because we're using the microphone and the computer, and over here picking up Dean and Tory and Mark, you're not hearing it real great. Hopefully, I've got a guy working on it. My tech guy, is a buddy of mine, is actually helping me figure out how we can use these microphones for Facebook Live at the same time as when we do the podcast. And so if we can do that, it'd be absolutely fantastic. So what are you trying to figure out how we're going to do it, Dean?
I'm looking for the USB.
It's on the very back.
I was looking over there. Yeah.
I still want to plug the headphone jack in and then wear my hearing protection. Yeah.
There you go.
To make it look official.
I could have possibly,
to make it look cool.
I could have possibly had this done today, but each microphone came with two cables. I lost the other ones. I lost the USB cables that were tall. I don't know where the hell they went. They may have gone in the trash.
But maybe it stuck to your Velcro holster or something.
Yeah, it could have.
Right there next to all those
short and curly
pubes. Damn jokers.
Pubes.
So, anything else, guys? Come on.
Yeah, with the appendix carry.
You could talk all day.
Oh, it's all good.
I like it.
I
Go for it.
It's my thing.
We are so unorganized this week.
That's
we've been going
just this week. Just this week.
you don't gotta lie to kick it. Like, just tell me. With the appendix carry, I'm obviously a great big advocate for it. I am. With training.
Right.
Even if it's just watching YouTube, because there's a lot of YouTube videos out there that will teach you quite a bit.
Use a holster.
Yeah. Use a holster.
Use a holster. That sounds ridiculous, but how many? Yeah. Use a holster.
It does sound ridiculous, but repetition. Just like one of the guys that I like to watch a lot, you guys probably might have seen him. It's called Instructor Zero.
Yes.
I like watching a lot of his stuff because he talks and he'll slow break it down for you. And I'll go out and I'll dry fire so many times before I actually put any. I've shot with blanks before. And my biggest thing is the reason I like mine so much is it teaches you to basically when you're gripping your pistol and you have that trigger finger on the slide, where I put mine is I've already got it over the top of my belt. So when it comes out, it's already there. My finger will never, ever be on the trigger until I am 100% in front of me and I know what's out there. Because before mine's ever drawn, target or no target, I'm going to know what's in front of me and I'm going to know what the repercussions of what happens in front of me is going to be later.
Right.
So, I mean, I'm a big advocate for it. And a lot of people have asked me, comfort. Yeah, how do you drive with it? My thing is
you drive.
Yeah, you just... Maybe it's because I've packed it. Don't get me wrong. When I first started putting them on, it was uncomfortable.
Let me throw this out there, and I forget the guy who said this, but carrying a gun, doesn't matter where you carry it, should never be 100% comfortable.
Never.
It's supposed to be comforting, not comfortable. You should always know you have the firearm there. Yep. It reminds you that you have it there, so you respect it, you pay attention to it, you don't get relaxed about it and forget it's there, and then have bad things happen.
I mean, hindsight's 20/20.
Right.
Keister carry.
As long as hindsight and keister carry.
Dean's really into that. Dean's really into the keister carry.
Use your brown eye to have hindsight.
So where do you carry, Dean?
I pocket carry.
You pocket carry? You use a pocket holster?
It's these motorcycle jackets
Dean,
that I wear.
Do you use a pocket holster?
No.
Why not?
Because there is an elastic piece in there that covers the trigger. And covers the whole gun.
Gentleman's pocket.
Yeah. What?
Gentleman's pocket.
Yeah.
Same idea as what's here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Gentleman's pocket.
It's specifically made to cover the whatever firearm that you
just
put
Sons
in there.
Of Anarchy code, isn't it?
Yes.
It is. Yeah.
I bought.
You want to see? You want to see? I'll pretend I'm at the gun counter and I'll haul it out.
No, it's just this big.
Oh, I got you.
Big inside
that's
my
exactly,
jacket.
Yeah.
Okay.
And there's a big elastic piece in there that holds it down.
Oh, nice.
And so in this jacket, it's perfect for a J-frame revolver, and that's what I carry in this jacket. In my other jacket that I got, I put my Glock in there. It's a Glock Model 30. The only problem with that jacket is, you see how this has to get to it, you just pull these two snaps open, and the handle is right there. In my other jacket, it carries the pistol straight down, so the barrel is straight down.
You have to actually reach around.
So you have to pull the thing open, then reach clear around, dig around to get the handle, and then you got to lift up and then ease it around to get the thing out. Yeah. So it's not very well thought out. It's like Bowler Hat Guy from Meet the Robertsons. I don't think you really thought this through very well.
So do you don't never carry your 1911, do you?
No, it's too pretty.
Oh, good lord!
I don't want to get pubes on it.
Love them.
You carry your 1911
all the time.
This guy's got a really nice one. He doesn't do anything with it.
I just shoot it.
I wouldn't say mine's super nice. I have a Springfield Range Officer.
Right.
That's a good super one. Nice.
Those are
it's good. A good gun. Yeah.
Have I done? I brought in a 1911 guy, a revolver guy, a 41 Magnum guy.
they call this a gang war.
The gang war is what it is. I'm feeling ganged up. Well, you're pretty silent over there too, Mark. What are you thinking about all this?
Thinking about my guns at home. I wonder if they're thinking about me, you know.
Thinking maybe I should buy a 1911.
But not a variant.
Get not a variant.
Yeah. Please don't. Like I'm lucky where I can look at 1911s all day long.
Right.
And then I get my fix on 1911s. Otherwise, I don't know.
You're good. Yeah.
Yeah.
So where do you carry?
Just hip.
Hip. What kind of holster do you use?
I use depends on what gun I'm carrying. Blade Tech, Alien Gear.
How do you like the Alien Gear stuff?
I love it, but it makes me sweat.
We need a sponsorship, okay. Alien Gear. Because I don't know if you ever see this.
It's got the neoprene. So it's like a hybrid. It's a neoprene, leather, and then Kydex outer shell.
Uh-huh.
I've got the Al-Kydex one. I'm not a big fan.
Al-Kydex?
Al-Kydex, yeah.
The Blade Tech is, I think, by far my favorite.
The Blade Tech?
And it's just a hard Kydex shell. But
see, I've looked at them. Fits. Are they pretty comfortable?
It fits great, and it's very comfortable for me.
I've looked at them.
I've got lots of crossbreeds that I use. You know, crossbreed super tucks. I'll use those some on Sunday sometimes. And even I got the crossbreed belly band, which is really cool because it's got the Velcro in it and it's got a Kydex shell that'll Velcro to it. And you can actually move that around wherever you want, which is pretty slick, actually.
Yeah. I do Thunderwear. Carry, like, Serpa. I have some Serpa ones for like my M&P and my, my SIG and stuff. But that's just outside the waist carry. That's
sure. I've got one of those.
Up in the mountains or whatever where I'm just, I don't even care.
I got my Incog over there.
Mm-hmm. Those incogs are nice. I like the incogs.
Yeah, but it's not bad for appendix carry. I kind of like it. So
the Serpas are the Blackhawk Serpas. Yeah, those are really nice. Click into place. I bought one that's removable and it's got like the belt loops in it.
Right.
Yeah.
And it actually attaches to my
carrier. And I like them because they have that button that you push, and when you pull the gun out, your fingers lined right up along the slide. It's not right on the trigger.
Yeah.
So that's what I like about the Serpo style ones is they're set up really great for that.
Since
they
we're
have good retention too. So.
See, since we're talking about holsters here, Philip, our buddy Philip.
Hey, Phil.
Philip, he says he's heard that saying about guns should be comforting, not comfortable. He says he's heard that saying too, but his issue is the gun needs to be comfortable so you're not adjusting it all the time.
That's true.
I'm going to tell you right now that if you're adjusting your firearm all the time, look in it. I've been there. We've all been there. Look into a good gun belt.
Yep.
A good gun belt is worth its weight in gold. And see, plan on spending anywhere from $60 to $90 on it.
That's why I like these canvas belts from the military. I have hundreds of them.
I got this one. It's a real thick leather belt.
Yep.
My buddy made it for me, and actually it's real stout, and it works really well. So they make some leather that has a Kydex center that is real good.
I've talked to a few people on belts, and they say don't go buy a good gun belt. Just go to DMB or like co-op and just find a thick leather belt.
Thick leather. Yeah. What you want is a belt that when you it's going to hold its shape.
Yep.
So when you buckle it, it's going to hold its shape and not collapse on itself. Yep. A good gun belt will night and day. It'll support it. It won't pull your, sag your pants down. So your pants aren't supporting it. The gun belt is. Yep. So, Philip, if you're still looking, go or. He uses a Riggers belt, which is awesome. So.
Yeah, Riggers belt.
So, okay, you're running down the right road there. Just find a holster that works. He says he uses Alien Gear too. He really likes it. So,
I was looking at the Alien Gear ankle rigs because Tarver got me thinking about that.
Oh yeah, because he uses
he is an ankle rig. Yeah,
I just have the cloak tuck.
I've read a lot about ankle gear. I don't have big enough pants for it.
So I actually you do depending on what you use. So I used to carry two guns. Yeah, just because I could. I'd carry one in my crossbreed on my waist and on my hip. And
they called him Two Gun Todd.
Two Gun Todd. They made a movie about two guns.
And so then I have a, I can't even remember what brand it is. I still got it. It's an ankle rig, and I had jeans just like yours and just a smaller gun, and I'd carry my little 9x18 Makarov clone down there, and it was kind of cool.
Yeah.
You want me to say the name of it? My Feg.
Yep. Whoa.
Whoa.
That escalated fast.
That will also be behind the paywall on Patriot.
It was my Feg. FEG is what they called it.
That was your first pistol, right?
PA. Yeah. PA. Yeah. I can't remember the number on it. PA something. It was a 9x18 Makarov clone. It was out of, God dang it. That one was Hungarian, I think. So it's a good little gun. I wish I still had it. I traded it for some stupid broken 308, which is I didn't know it was broken at the time. So it was one of the only gun trades I've ever done. I'll never do another one again. I just keep them and buy more.
Yep, true.
I think the only gun trades that happened in my life are between me and my dad, because I know somewhere along the lines, it's bad to say, but I'm going to end up with all them guns again. So my dad doesn't sell anything.
That's not a bad thing, man.
No. We'll trade back and forth. Like I had a Glock 21. I ended up with that 1911. Traded straight across for it. I got a way better.
He doesn't care because you're going to get him back.
I'm
going to
get him back. We've traded that. I think I've had that same Glock three different times. He'll trade it to me for one of mine. I'll trade it for mine. Trade it for one of his.
That's a pretty good deal.
Yeah.
So Philip has a question. He wants to know, he's looking into the alien gear shapeshifter. Does anyone know anything about that? I'm not an alien gear guy.
I'm not an alien gear.
Do you look?
I looked for a while when I was looking for mine.
Is that the one that's modular and changes?
I think you can change the. Yeah, I mean, I know on mine I can move the, you know, cant it forward and do all that stuff.
Is that
but
the one that comes in the big ass fancy box?
It might. I'm not sure. I know. I should know more about them because they're made here in Idaho. But
yeah, but do they throw in a sticker with it?
They do. I do. They stick it to the outside of the damn box.
I actually have the alien gear sticker in my truck. So.
Oh, they didn't stick it to the box?
No.
Yeah, oh, this holster, they freaking stuck it to the box. You want me to advertise for you? You spent $200. You can't even send me a damn sticker that I can peel and stick myself.
Yeah. Alien gear is right here in Idaho, too. So.
Yeah, they're up up north.
North, yeah.
Yeah, so Hayden, is it Hayden Lake? Or
somewhere around there, yeah.
What?
Crossfires here in Idaho,
that's
too.
Where all those Aryans are.
Oh, they moved.
They're not there anymore.
They're over in Montana.
Alabama is where I thought they moved. Oh, but
that's quite a move. Alabama, Montana, there's no.
Kentucky.
Either way, they started voting Democrat. I don't know.
Oh, God.
Okay. We really have got a new show where we get a little, I don't know, some structure.
Structure.
We need some structure. Courseware. So you listen. Focus. You listen to the podcast.
I do.
So do we have a good? Okay, you may say bad stuff about the podcast.
Oh,
so
that's so ear muffet.
It's all.
You're telling me ear muffet.
We got thick skin.
It's good.
So do we need to follow more of a structure, or do you just like the way we just sometimes you just come in here and just talk? Is it good? Just,
if you look at any podcast you listen to, anybody they talk about. I don't know if you know who Dr. Nick is.
Redbone, no. Yeah. I don't listen to that.
I've listened to a few of them. And he's got a structure on what he's going to talk about. And a few other podcasts and people out of Boise I listen to.
Right.
I mean, they have a structure for about the first 10 minutes. And then it's kind of, they have a period. Okay, we're going to go 10 minutes. Like, you're going to talk for a few minutes. You're going to talk for a few minutes. I'm going to talk.
And they just bullshit the rest of the show. We're not doing too bad,
unlike
guys.
Us. We just bullshit the whole thing.
You have somewhat of a structure in the sense that what did you do, Second Amendment related? What did you do? What did I do? What did you do? And then
let me discuss articles.
And the thing is how you respond to your comments.
Right. So do you like right the there. Facebook Live?
Yeah, I do.
Is that cool?
It works.
I don't
today,
get it.
I tell you right now, the biggest advertising tool in today's world is social media.
Yeah, I try to keep up on it the best I can. So
I hate to say it, but I keep up on it quite a bit because that's where I find a lot of my gun related posts or political posts.
I have to. It sells my classes. I mean, and I that and text messaging. Not very often do people call me.
Nope.
It's all about text messaging. It's all about Facebook messaging. And now I'm on Instagram. And so I just kind of combine those two things. And I'm on there more than my kids, probably.
The worst thing is when you're texting somebody back and forth, and then you call them right after you got the last text and they don't answer the phone. So 2 seconds ago, you were looking at your phone, texting me. Now you're not going to answer it.
Yeah, I'd rather do everything via text. It's easier. I can answer
it
back.
It is way easier.
There's a reason why I wouldn't do it. It's because I'd probably doing it at work.
Texting
at work, and then somebody tries to call me. I'm like,
I do that all the time. I hide in the corner of the food plant, and I'm answering.
Yeah, but you don't have cameras like
staring right at
down
you.
At you.
It's a food plant. You'd be amazed at where they have cameras. Yeah. Trust me.
Yeah, majority of the cameras in our store are facing right at the gun counter.
The gun counter. Which, I mean, and I am super happy with DMB's gun counter. I didn't even know you guys had that.
Oh,
I just happened to walk in there one day because I needed some pants. I'm like, oh, I forgot all about it. I think I walked out of there with no pants.
Detour.
You went to the gun counter and you left with
no pants? You left with no pants?
Yeah,
what in the world?
They took everything I owned plus my pants.
There you go. I don't know what you were doing at the gun counter.
I don't require pants as far.
They say no shoes, no shirt, but
pants are optional.
Boots and pants and boots.
Y'all better be wearing white tidy skivvies and boots.
So has anyone bought a 3D printer yet?
Is that a new gun or what is that?
I want to print the gun.
You got a 3D printed gun right there.
Did we talk about the video that the guy put on there when he tried to shoot it?
Did you see the video?
I did see the video.
I didn't watch it. Tell
I
us all about
it. I laughed my guts out. The thing exploded, of course.
It's plastic.
It's plastic. There's no way it can hold
it's
in
good
the pressure
for
of
maybe
cartridge.
One, maybe two shots, maybe.
That's not a, that's even a no, hard.
You didn't even go one.
Didn't it, one and it just exploded.
The and the thing of it is, they look like they don't even look like a gun. They look like a
kitchen utensil.
It looks like a toy. I mean, a Nerf gun looks better.
Looks more like a gun.
More resemblance. Yeah. I don't know. I
did see it and like an AR that somebody had, right. And then they put Nerf stickers all over it. And it's like it's like saying my AR identifies as a Nerf gun or something like that.
There you go.
Does it get its own restroom?
So you know what we still need to do, and we are so far behind.
Florida man. No, I don't know.
No one's gonna believe us when we have a con. Here it is, like a month late. We have to draw.
Oh yeah,
we haven't even drawn a name for the freaking hat and sticker yet.
Did anyone give us like a legitimate?
We had like three of them.
Shithole carry.
Shithole carry.
What? Oh no! What was it?
Crappy carry.
Crappy carry. Fancy
carry. Crappy carry.
Different verbiage. Same thing. Yeah.
Wait, that's keister carry. Sorry.
Yeah.
Fancy gun. Crappy carry.
So I'll tell you what. I am. We won't do it right now. I need to look up actually who sent us pictures again. I forgot. And we'll draw a name and all.
I know who I would pick right off the bat, but
okay, who would you pick?
Josh, because he went hunting for him.
Oh yeah, he did. He went.
I do.
Down.
Okay, Josh. Guess what, Josh? You want a hat and a sticker? How big's your freaking gourd? You let me know. Is it a medium, small, or large, extra large? Let me know. I'm waiting for an answer.
Yeah. So I'm wearing an axe murderer huge.
So he wins. In fact, I may be doing something with Josh here pretty soon. Patriot Defense might expand to Boise a little bit.
Do some classes over there?
Maybe. I'm trying to work out the pros and cons. Kind of wants to maybe do some classes in Patriot Defense's name, so we might try to work something out. But I'm having kind of a control issue. Yeah. I don't want to let it go out of my control. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. Just something I'm
true.
Something I'm thinking about. I'm supposed to call him Sunday and chat with him. So.
Yeah, he actually went hunting for those pictures and stuff.
He did.
I got to give him credit for that one.
He'd walk through Walmart and he'd like hunt people down or like follow him with like snap pictures of them.
I've seen a few. I saw the old Circle K over on Kimberly Road. That was the Shell station right there on Locust.
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah.
It was. I walked in there one day. It had to have been a couple years ago. I walked in there and a guy had a 1911 in what looked like an Uncle Mike's 380 holster.
Oh,
I'm
sweet.
Talking this much
that
barrel
fit well.
At the bottom, no overstrap, no protection, and he was just slinging it. And I just happened to get done hunting, so I had my pistol on my side, and he goes, "Oh, that's a sweet pistol. I got mine here," and I'm okay.
That, you know, the funniest thing is when you see those people walking around town with the draw plague holsters.
Oh, yeah. I've seen that a couple of times. And I've seen a few that are actually legit draw plague, but they don't go with the attire. And I've held my back so many held myself back so many times on that 1911. Like, I just wanted to reach up and grab it.
Well, the
this is mine now.
Well, yeah. So the worst one I've ever seen, I've talked about it before, is a guy in Walmart. He was carrying. He didn't have his magazine in. No, he had his magazine in, but the slide was locked back and it was in his holster and he's walking around Walmart.
I don't know why I got reminded of this, but this was years and years ago at Sportsman's Warehouse. A guy went into the bathroom and sat down, whatever, took his gun off, sat it down, and left the bathroom without his gun.
Where was this at?
Sportsman's Warehouse.
He left his pistol in the shed.
That's a big 1911, I believe.
That's a big no.
You should never have to unholster your freaking handgun.
This was many years ago, and he left and came back, like, I don't know.
That's right,
because
he used to work there.
15 minutes later, maybe, and it was gone. I mean,
someone ripped it off.
Oh, yeah, somebody had taken it. And no, I mean, they didn't come and turn it in to anybody. They walked out with it.
Well, of course not. You can't expect that in today's world.
Yeah.
No way.
Yeah, someone walks into the bathroom and goes, "What in the world's this guy been eating?"
So yeah, you should never have to take your gun out of the holster or even remove your holster if you're using the facility. Mm-hmm. Use
That's
a proper
why I like
holster.
This so much.
Yeah.
You just pull it off to the belt. And I mean, like whoever's in the stall next to me might see it under the stall, but I just roll it. Inside my
yeah, mm-hmm. There's ways to do it. Yeah. You know how many guns are left on the back of freaking toilets every year?
Yeah.
Tons of them. There's article after article after article after article.
I don't know why I just got reminded of that just talking about different stuff, but
I can't believe that's a thing.
Oh yeah, that's a big, yeah, that's it's a big thing.
Yeah, it's holy bad.
Balls. I roll it. Like, yeah, I tuck it in, and then
yeah.
Or if you have to take it off, dude, you set
it on your leg.
You set it in the white hammock.
True.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm not above it. I've done it.
Yeah. So, but if you get a good holster, you don't even have to freaking take it off your belt. That's just the way it goes. Yep. So. Dean's true. Like, I've never heard of that before.
I don't.
I think I remember hearing something about that.
This has been like, I couldn't even remember how long ago this was.
There was a lady that got a hold of me, and I won't say her name because she was pretty embarrassed by it. This was a few years back. And she'd taken my class, got her permit, and I forget exactly how she was carrying. I think she might have been carrying in a shirt that had a pocket in it, you know? And the gun didn't fit in there like it should. And she was grocery shopping, and she bent down, and it fell out.
Ooh.
And it skittered across the floor. I forget. I think she was, like, in Winco or somewhere. And she looked around, and she ran over and grabbed it and shoved it. She shoved it back. I think she shoved it and dropped it in a pocket in her purse. And she went in the bathroom and was like, and she's like, she didn't even finish getting her groceries. She just quit and like went home. And then she messaged me and she was all kinds of freaking out. I need help. We got to figure something out. I forget exactly what she got figured out, but that's a big deal. That's buy a proper holster, something that your gun is going to fit into.
Something's going to retain it. I mean, even me with my little pocket carry.
Yep.
They ain't falling out.
You know, as bad as it sounds, even if you're in the grocery store and you don't feel comfortable with it, if you've got a big pocket, unload it, put it in your pocket. Go in the bathroom, unload it, put it in your pocket.
Something.
It's not going to come
worst case scenario, but yeah, if you don't feel comfortable with it, just don't freaking wear it. You get something that a proper holster that'll fit.
See, and that's like, especially with the uncomfortable thing, like my wife. Because when we took the class, I don't know if you remember that little Glock 26.
That was a big-ass class.
It was. Actually, the one key thing, I won your little bullseye thing.
That's right. I remember that.
And then I had that knurl knob. You said I lost it.
The what?
My threaded barrel.
Yeah, yeah.
But she had that Glock 26. And she liked it because it was small. It fit right in her purse.
Right.
But she just didn't like the snap. And I always told her, I don't want to carry. I was like, you know, you don't have to carry. I mean, I'm with you 100% of the time when we go places. So one of us is carrying.
Right.
I'm not worried about you carrying all. If you don't feel comfortable, don't carry it. And she's never been into guns.
She doesn't carry.
Mm-mm. She does, like, it's under the seat in the car because she works for the bank and she was always taking, like, or not so much for the bank, but like for Title Fact, taking a deposit somewhere.
Okay, right.
Under the seat of the car. And I mean, it's still, even then, it's in a holster that's completely snapped and buttoned. It's not just sitting on the floor of the car.
Right.
And I always told her, she always asked me, I don't want to keep one in the barrel. It's like, well, then what's the point of carrying it?
Right.
It's in that holster. Yeah, it's an expensive paperweight after that.
Yeah.
But it's in that, I have the big Galco leather holster, and it's just wrapped up, and this is one snap, and then you're ready to go, but it's under that seat of the car, and it's not going anywhere.
Right.
If you don't want to carry it on, you don't carry it on you. And I will never force anybody to carry one.
Well, you don't ever want to do that, because that's when accidents and bad things happen. That's why, you know, you talk about teachers and guns and stuff, and, you know, nothing against Trump, but Trump was saying, hey, he thinks that they need to give teachers that carry a little more pay. Well, I think that's the wrong way to look at it, because you're going to get teachers that want a little more pay, so they're going to carry, and they're not going to be all in. You got to be all in. Yep. And if you're not, you're just doing it for the wrong reasons, you're going to be sloppy about it. That's when you're going to be irresponsible with it. You're not going to pay attention to it. You're not going to do it right. You're not going to be all in, and that's when bad things happen. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, well, guys, anything else? Should we wrap her up?
Well, I got one thing.
Sure. Go for it.
The age old question. I've had a few of my friends, mainly my wife asked me once, main question that everybody asked me, if it came down to it, could you really shoot somebody?
Yeah.
I mean, if it came down to it, like, and the way that I've explained it to everybody, if we're in a scenario, like I always just play a scenario, like we're in a gas station.
Sure.
Somebody comes in to rob the gas station. If they're there to rob the gas station, I'm an innocent. I'm a good witness. I'm a damn good witness.
But you have your gun if it turns south.
Especially if somebody sees me and, like, you know, God forsake, I'm open carrying. And like, you're robbing the gas station and you see me like looking at me like, are you going to pull that? Well, no, I'm not. I mean, it's here to protect me.
I get those people
in
class.
You're not mall cop. You're not the vigilante.
Yeah, it's not. If he's going to rob the store, my life and your life, per se, is not worth the $200 in the cash register.
So I want to pick on my wife a little bit. She's changed her thinking now. She doesn't She doesn't carry. I'll throw that out there. She doesn't carry like I would like her to. But years ago, we didn't even live in the state. We were in Kansas at the time. And I was trying to convince her, let's get your concealed carry permit. Get your concealed carry permit. Let's do this. She actually told me, she goes, I don't feel comfortable with it. I don't know if I could even use it if I had to. Mm-hmm. And I thought about that for a little while. And I came back to her and I said, you know, your mom, you got five kids. Or back then, we only had four kids. You got four kids. I said, as a mom, what would you do for your kids? Well, I'd do anything for my kids. I'm like, really? Because you just told me you wouldn't at this point. Would you protect them? Would you fight if someone tried to take them? Would you fight for them? What would you do? Would you protect them? Well, I'd do anything that it took. She didn't realize what direction I was going with it. And I was like, well, would you shoot someone for them? And she thought about it. She goes, probably that would be the one thing that would push me over the edge, that I would do whatever I had to do. So there's a family member. You know, on my wife's side of the family, and she's an older gal. She lives alone, never been married. And years ago, we got into a discussion on Facebook, and she said something, and I smarted off to her and said something about guns, and she goes, "Oh, I never have one of those. That's the wrong with those evil semi-automatic pistols and all this stuff." And I said, "Hey, look, I said let me state this, put this out here for you. I'm gonna ask you a question. You live alone. You always have lived alone. No one lives with you." I said, what are you going to do? I said, if you had a firearm and it was laying on the nightstand and it was loaded and ready to go, and on one side of you, and on the other nightstand, on the other side of the bed, you had a phone, and you woke up in the middle of the night and there's some strange guy in your bedroom standing at the foot of your bed, what are you going to do? She goes, well, I call the police. I'm not going to shoot him. I wouldn't do it. It's not in her to do anything like that. She hates guns. She's scared of them. She said that actually that happened once. And she screamed, and he yelled, and he ran out. And I'm like, because you know what? Here's the thing. You know, you grab that phone. Nothing is law enforcement. They're going to be 10, 15 minutes out, typically.
You're dead.
I said, that person is at the freaking end of your bed. You got a loaded
gun. Jogger in, was it Iowa or Ohio?
Iowa.
In Iowa. She had a phone. She threatened to use it. She wound up dead.
Yep.
Yeah. So that's always a story I tell everyone. You know, tell me what you're going to do.
You won't even get the number dialed.
Yeah, you know, you won't. Yeah.
I mean, you wouldn't even probably get to your phone.
I'll state this. I'll state that a gun is a good thing to have in that situation, but you know what? You're going to play hell just getting to your gun in time, let alone picking up a phone and dialing it.
It's violence of action.
By the time you pick up that gun, that guy's going to he's either going to run out, or he's going to be on top of you already, and you're going to be shooting like this. And that's the way it's going to be.
My theory is this. It's equal and opposite reaction.
Yep.
So if there's a case where I am actively being shot at, then my reaction first is get behind cover.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Because everybody says, oh, I'm going to shoot back. That's bullshit. I've been shot at twice. Your first reaction is to get down and get behind cover.
Yep. Right.
Then you can shoot back.
See, I've been shot at one time my whole life deer hunting. That's why I will never wear orange again. I mean, somebody just sees something. Bushes moving. Mm-hmm. And there's so many people out there that are first-time hunters. Oh, I see something. Bam. First thing you do is I'm sitting down. I'm getting behind something. It might not protect me, but I'm sitting down. I'm going to figure out where it came from, what's happening. It could be an accident. It could be a 14-year-old kid. I'm not automatically going to pick my rifle up, whatever I have at the time, and shoot back, because it could be an accident. You don't know what's happening on the other end of that. Mm-hmm. Granted, it could be somebody that's just out there to shoot somebody. You don't know that, though. You can't predict something like that.
So here's one. The one time I was shot at, the guy, I actually took him shooting, and he was walking across this ridge line above me, and he thought it would be funny to just shoot at me.
What?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, no kidding.
Wow.
Never went shooting with him again, and I'm very, very picky on who I go shooting with.
Wow.
And now that guy who did that is a lobbyist in Washington, D.C., and he's very much a Democrat.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's an insane story.
Yeah, isn't that just the craziest thing?
Every story I got.
Well, you know he's mentally ill because he's lobbying Democrats.
Probably, yeah.
Was he all there? When you went out with him?
That's the thing.
He was funny. Everybody thought he was funny. But looking back, he was weird. Really crazy. I mean,
that's
probably not. No.
That's stuff you'll never be able to predict. Look at Chris Kyle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was helping veterans.
Right.
Yes.
You don't know when it's going to happen.
You don't. Yeah.
Hell, I took my kid. I was taking my kid freaking catfishing in Kansas when I had my experience. I didn't get shot at, but that's when that situation came where I had to draw my firearm. I didn't think it was going to happen that day. I was taking my freaking 4-year-old fishing. Someplace I'd been a dozen times. Yep. You just don't ever know. So, you know, you were talking about the reaction, or you were talking about the reaction. First thing you're going to do is if someone is there, you're going to hide, get down, whatever. It's, you know, we teach those women in the ladies class how to draw the firearm. And part of that is we kind of have freaking dog. Part of it is, and we haven't we touched on it a little bit, but it's all about drawing the firearm and actually getting off the X, getting out of the way, taking cover, getting out of, you know, resetting the OODA loop.
Yeah.
He likes that word.
You want to be focused on your target, but you also want to find cover.
Right.
You know, because you want to know where the threat's coming from, but at the same time, you want to get to protection.
Like, well, and that's what we teach. You know, you draw your firearm and get off the X. Draw your firearm, and then you're punching the firearm out as you're stepping backwards,
as you're
creating distance, as you're getting off the X, all that kind of stuff. So,
and that's, I mean, they train us
human
that.
Reaction.
They train us that in the military. That is the key phrase: get off the X.
Right.
You don't see you're driving down the road and somebody shoots at your Humvee. We're not all just gonna hop out. Oh, where'd that come from?
Right.
That's no. That's a big no.
Right.
Everything you're sitting in is 100% bulletproof.
Right.
You're looking around. They call it a 5-10s or 5s and 25s, 0-5s, 25s. You look out the door at 0, you look out at 5 meters, and you look out farther at 25 meters.
Right.
I could go on for this for hours, but my biggest piece of advice is train.
Oh, yeah.
And when it comes down to it, everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the face.
Train. Yeah. The muscle memory. You got to know how to react. You got to know how to get off the X. You got to know how to draw your firearm, because when the shit hits the fan, you don't know what you're gonna do. If you've never been in a situation, you don't know if you're gonna freeze up. You don't know if you're gonna turn tail and run. You have no idea what you're gonna do. So if you train for it and you develop that muscle memory, when it happens, your body already knows where to go and what to do. Hopefully, and it may not be 100%, but at least you've given it direction.
You've got the effort. You've got the idea.
Right.
Like what is it? Like 80%? You're gonna miss like 80% of your shots and stuff like that.
Yeah. So I think
the way to train, definitely shoot a lot, but build up your heart rate, like get yourself ready for a situation.
Train as you would
as
fight.
You fight. Yeah. Train it. Yep.
I mean, don't go looking for trouble, but if it comes,
and then
be prepared.
The other saying is your body will never go where your mind's never been.
Nope.
So it's all about muscle memory. It's all about developing it, using it.
I mean, I take steps. You know, just going to the movie theater or something. My kids hate me, but you know, I sit all the way to the back of the movie theater.
Yeah,
and like, and if I go into a restaurant, I try and sit.
Afford to go to the movies anymore?
With my back to the wall,
face to the door.
I want to see everything. You know,
that's, and you can ask. Yeah, same thing. You can ask my wife. I'm a people watcher. It doesn't matter if we go to Jack in the Box or the most expensive restaurant in Twin. Sit down. She'll be talking to me, and I'm listening to her. Don't get me wrong.
Right.
We're talking. But I'm seeing everything.
You're watching everything.
I'm watching who's coming.
My kids hate me for it because they always want to sit like, you know, in the middle or something. And I'm just like, no, we're going all the way up. You know.
Well, be careful of the movie theater now. You can get shot for talking on for texting on a cell phone.
Yeah.
What is that? Did that happen?
Yeah. That happened. I can't remember where it was at, but somebody was trying to watch a movie. And you know how they have those big ads?
It's rude. Retired cop.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
It was a retired cop. At least this one I'm thinking of. So there's a new podcast that I've started listening to. It's actually really, really cool. It's called the Sword and Scale. And it actually takes crimes that are in trial or crimes that have happened, and it breaks them all down and goes through it from beginning to end, and it talks about where that person's mind was at and everything. It's pretty cool. And they actually covered that one, and I just got done listening to it earlier this week, and it was insane. I mean, the guy's wife was with him and wouldn't even back him up with what he said really happened. He just, like, snapped. And he kept telling this guy, hey, quit texting on your phone. Don't text on your phone. And the guy kept texting on his phone. He says, well, I'm going to get up and tell the manager. Got up and told the manager, came back. And the manager came in and talked to the guy who was on his phone. He quit. That guy said something to that guy. You know, I was texting my effing daughter or whatever it was. And he put his phone away and he goes, oh, I see how it is. You get off when the manager tells you to get off, but not when I tell you to get off. Then he said that guy turned around and threw something at him and hit him in the face. That guy threw popcorn, and as that guy was coming over the seat, the retired law enforcement guy pulled his gun out and shot him. But everyone that's in a lot of the people in the theater, and even the guy's wife, the old man's wife that was sitting next to him, didn't couldn't verify that he was hit with anything or the popcorn was even thrown. Or nobody it was cooperated. Anyhow, I'm not going to get into that.
Could they verify the guy was coming over the seat at him?
I don't know. I don't remember that part. I have to listen to it again.
So the stories didn't jive.
The guy's wife wouldn't even back him up.
Wow.
That's the one I was talking about. I read about it in the news. In my opinion, de-escalation.
Yeah.
True.
If the guy is making you that mad, I mean, there's thousands. I will be the first one. Yeah. If you can argue with me, like, I'll get up and leave the movie theater before I shoot somebody.
And that's what they said. That's what they said is, why didn't this guy, after he had the first altercation with the guy, why didn't he just get up and move? There's very few people in the movie theater. Why didn't he just get up and go sit in a different seat away from where the light from the phone wouldn't bother him? Right. Why didn't he do that? And anyhow, it's pretty trippy because they even discussed about how he drew his gun. I don't know actually how he was carrying, but how he drew his firearm really smoothly, and about how it was already out to a certain point. So they actually think he might have drawn it before the guy actually tried to attack him.
Oh,
and he'd already was programmed. It was pretty, it's a pretty interesting case, but good podcast if anyone wants to take a listen to it. It's
what's it called?
The Sword and Scale.
Save that.
Yeah, it's some of the episodes are boring because one episode it talks about a guy who's like schizophrenic and about how he starts off, they don't know he's schizophrenic, and he starts showing all these signs, and he ends up like killing his entire family. Hmm. And it walks you all the way through it.
That escalated fast.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting podcast. It gets a little graphic, just so you know.
I've seen some patients in clinic because we see a lot of prisoners that are just released because there's a special program where they give them the state will pay for their behavioral treatment, behavioral therapy, plus their medications.
Right.
And some of these guys that come and see me are scarier than hell.
Oh, yeah.
And like one guy would tell me he would be like just get road rage at the drop of a hat. And it would like a switch would turn and he would not turn off. And there was no way that he could calm down. So like this jagwagon cop in the movie theater keeps pestering this guy. Other guy's going to flip.
Egging it on.
How do you know if that person has some kind of mental illness?
Yeah.
And they're going to, their flip is going to get switched and they're going to come after you.
Yeah.
And you're not going to be able to back down. They're not reasonable.
Speaking of pissing people off, you guys will get a kick out of this. I don't even know what I did. And it was funny because the cops started laughing too. I am every month, one of my places of service is the county jail. And I got to go walk through the different cell blocks, and I got to go down and like spray the rear door and then come back out. And when the prisoners are being walked in, you just have to stop and kind of stand against the wall and, you know, and let them do their thing. Well, they were walking this one guy, and he must have been the worst of the worst that's in there because he had on, I don't know what it was. It wasn't the orange jumpsuit or anything like that. It was like this pad that like hangs over him. So I don't know. I don't know what. Anyhow. He's this little Hispanic dude. He comes walking down there. I stop. I look over at my guys who are with me, and they stop. So I stop. And I try not to stare at him. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to.
It's hard.
Don't make eye contact.
Yeah, and I didn't. I just kind of whatever. I don't look in cells or anything like that. And the one law enforcement officer escorting this guy, he goes into his cell. And as the guy goes into his cell, I turn, and they're shutting the doors. They hit the deal. The door goes to slide shut because it's automatic. And that little Mexican's hands come out, and he's all – right at me. And I'm like,
giving you double-fisted birds.
Yeah, the law enforcement guy goes, that's not at me. He goes, do you know him? And I'm like, I've never seen this guy in my life.
And I no longer spray the county jail.
Yeah, no, I just pumped that baby up. Bring it there. But anyhow, I irritated that guy. I guess spraying for ants was not what he wanted me to do today.
Oh, shit. That day. Well, it's probably because you're white.
Could have been, but it was freaking.
He could have been MS-13. You don't know.
He could have been. His tattoos were all covered up.
Exactly. That's but probably why he was mad.
It was freaking hilarious, though. That guy just all of a sudden he goes in. I mean, the doors they shut hard and fast, and these two hands come up, and he's like this. one of the cops with me is like, he must like you.
I'm not gonna let the man keep me down.
He's not advertising for prostate exams, if that's what you're thinking.
So, I think we're done for the day, guys.
That was a good one.
Why don't you tell them how they can get a hold of us? It's hanging on the wall there. I hung it back up with your gun.
Okay.
We haven't got a call forever.
You can call in on the pod. Have we had anybody call in on the
podcast? No, well, no, not for a while.
Okay.
Josh was the last one.
So let's say, let's do email first then.
Okay.
You can email us at patriotdefense13@yahoo.com. Again, the email is patriotdefense13@yahoo.com. If you do want to call in, the podcast hotline is 1-208-696-4397. You can also, if you catch us on the Facebook Live video, comment. We'll try and keep up with it and answer some questions or comments or anything.
And I think we need a call from the first-time listener, Zane.
Yeah.
And yeah. I think we need a call from South Carolina.
Yeah.
Careful, because he'll probably call me.
He can call the hotline and leave a little voice message.
The Palmetto State.
Yeah, the Palmetto State. There we go. Okay, I think we're done, guys.
Yeah, I'm good.
I think we're good. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it, Tory.
Tory, good fun. Show. Thanks for coming.
Yeah.